the smartest film critic in the world, Cole Smithey.
Hi, this is Cole Smithey with ColeSmithey.com, and your guide to what to see and what to avoid at the movies this week. Writer-director Jorge Michel Grau's feature debut is a trashy little horror exploitation film.
Although Grau might imagine that the film's Spanish family of prostitute-killing cannibals represent some cogent diatribe on the nature of capitalist existence, no such literary rigor is applied. The story is set in Mexico City, where a man inexplicably vomits up a black substance, perhaps oil, on a public sidewalk before perishing on the spot. It turns out he was the patriarch to a family of three teenage children and one bitch of a wife. Said father worked repairing watches at home when he wasn't killing and dragging home hookers that he and his family would eat in an unexplained cannibalistic ritual. With daddy gone, it's up to the would-be gay son Alfredo, played by Francesco Barrario, to bring home the meat. A couple of lazy, corrupt cops pretend to investigate the fate of the missing prostitutes. Grau makes a feeble attempt at sticking a post-it-sized life-affirming theme that says, "You are alive." Such shallow dribble does nothing to redeem the movie as anything more than a morbid waste of time and energy. I give this dreadful horror film a D-. This French entry for the 2010 Foreign Language Oscar is a plodding account of the predictable fate of eight French Christian monks living in war-torn Tiberine, Algeria during the 90s.
An Islamic fundamentalist group are ruthlessly killing locals and foreigners with equal impunity. Lambert Wilson plays the monk Christian, who leads his congregation's humanitarian efforts that include providing medical care for the local peasant community. Sequestered in their humble monastery, the monks go about daily rituals of prayer, chanting, reading, gardening, and beekeeping. Christmas is just a few weeks away when they are given an ultimatum for all foreigners to leave the country. Heated discussions follow among the monks about whether to stay or leave the community they have become an integral part of.
Espère tout, l'amour endure tout.
Choosing to forgo military protection by the government, even the local mayor demands the group leave. Missionaries are not, as a rule, a very pragmatic lot. Passive resistance only goes so far in bridging the gap between Christianity and Islamic beliefs. Director Xavier Beauvois captures the solemnity of the monks' existence. He casts a properly diffused light over a peaceful group of cultural interlopers willing to pay for their trespassing with their lives.
Qui souhaite rester?
Of Gods and Men is a chamber piece tragedy trapped in a bubble of naive optimism. A little cynicism could have gone a long way. I give this mediocre historical drama a C. Unrequited love in Montreal's chic world of privilege and parties is the theme of Xavier Dolan's quirky romantic comedy.
Marie, played by Monica Chokri, is a 25-year-old rebel with hard features she disguises under vintage clothing. Francis, played by the film's director, is Marie's best friend. He's a young gay man who's been through the mill of love more than a few times. The pair set themselves up for trouble when they become obsessed with an Adonis-like guy named Nicholas, played by Neil Schneider. Nicholas is a floppy-haired metrosexual who keeps people near him guessing about things like the depth of his carefully guarded intellect and his sexual orientation. Every everything in life comes easy for Nicholas, who has no problem leading Marie and Francis on with equal temptation. A vacation to the countryside offers the promise of a ménage à trois if only these tongue-tied characters can verbally articulate such an obvious idea. Nicholas, Marie, and Francis are adept at alluding to distant influences like Audrey Hepburn and Manichaean cosmology. Yet sorting out the reality of their personal interactions takes a brand of focus they have yet to conquer.
Heartbeats is a witty movie for 20-something misfits who almost know what they want. I give this fair romantic farce a B-.
My sleeper pick is The Last Lions, and my guilty pleasure pick is Unknown. My must-have DVDs are Get Low from Sony Pictures Classics, Mayreen Killer Instinct Part 1 from Music Box Films, and The Sweet Smell of Success from Criterion.
If you want to be happy, marry a girl like my sweet little Jane. Marry a stupid woman.
Hungarian director Alexander Korda's 1933 production of The Private Life of Henry VIII became Britain's first internationally successful film. Charles Laughton won an Oscar for his portrayal of the corpulent king with a reputation for incurring the deaths of his wives.
The film's sense of British nationalism comes through in Laughton's earnest delivery of the line, "Diplomacy, I'm an Englishman, I can't say one thing and mean another." Although larded with historical inaccuracies, The Private Life of Henry VIII carries off its promised tone of gossipy behind-the-scenes Tudor dynasty action. There's humor in the film's early juxtaposition of the former Queen Anne Boleyn's beheading on the same day as King Henry's third marriage to Boleyn's maid, Jane Seymour, played by Wendy Berry. Henry already has his eye on Lady Catherine Howard, played by Benny Barnes, an opportunist of the court engaged in a private affair with Henry's courtier, Thomas Culpepper, played by Robert Dunott. A secret visit to Catherine's room allows her to exert the upper hand. She questions whether he seeks admittance as Henry the King or as Henry the Man. Only when he admits that it is a command from the King does she open her bedroom door. Charles Laughton's real-life wife, Elsa Lanchester, mugs up a storm as Henry's sexually naive yet masculine-minded fourth wife, Anne of Cleves. Her comic performance sticks to the film like chewing gum on a 500-year-old statue. Korda encourages such benchmark cinematic moments as when Laughton breaks the fourth wall on two dramatic occasions to play directly into the camera lens. The first comes at the moment when King Henry discovers his third wife has died after giving birth to a son. Laughton plays the emotion for all of its political import, uttering an obligatory "God rest her sweet soul," before breaking the sentiment to focus on his infant prince Edward. The jolting scene represents a flourish of confidence on the part of the director and his star actor.
The film's most famous bit, however, involves Laughton eating a chicken with a primal gusto that clearly defines King Henry's character as a wasteful man devouring whatever is put before him. Thanks for watching, and visit colesmithy.com for more. Thank you.